Welcome everybody this morning. I'm going to be running through the amount basically to my entire life in about, what, how many minutes do I have?
We have an hour.
An hour. In an hour, I'm going to be running through my life as an example of the kind of life a blind person might have. And particularly because of what I do for a living, I'm going to be putting quite a bit of emphasis on how technology plays part in that. So, again, this is a bit autobiographical. Autobiographical, but it's also with the understanding that my life is not typical. It's typical for me, but it's not typical for blind people. And I'll try to draw your attention to when my life and the lives of most blind people diverge. First off, my history. I'm 54 years of age. Second born of five children to Mary and Jerry Charlson. Blue-collar family living in Milwaukee, Oregon, which is just south of Portland, Oregon. My father was a policeman who was the guy who in the local grocery store made sure all the food. My mother worked in an assembly plant part-time putting together the oscilloscopes that preceded much of today's technology. They were also very much part of an extended family. Our next-door neighbors were my great-grandmother and grandmother. Down the street about four blocks were my aunts, uncles, and great-uncles and great-aunts, all that kind of stuff, spread around the greater Milwaukee, Portland, Oregon area. So it's definitely an extended family. First born in my family, my brother Brad. Shortly thereafter, about a year and a half, myself. And then three kids rapidly thereafter. So all of us were teenagers at the same time. But when only one of us was a teenager, when my brother Brad was 13 and I was 11, one summer, while my dad was next door mowing my grandmother's lawn, and my mother was off at a bowling tournament, my other brothers and sisters were wherever in the neighborhood. That's back in the day when you could play, you assumed that your children were safe as long as they were in the neighborhood. So they were off doing their thing. I went into our home in the backyard, went into the kitchen, and pulled out of the trash can a bottle with a screw-on plastic cap. And then I crawled up on the kitchen counter and pulled down baking soda and distilled white vinegar. Anybody here know much about chemistry? One is a base and one is an acid. And the goal here was to put in some baking soda, top it off with vinegar, screw on the cap, run to the back door of the kitchen, open it up, and throw this bottle into the blackberry bushes that pretty much occupied our entire backyard. To watch it explode and with shrapnel, get the blackberry. Well, I had the bottle about here when it went off. And the explosion smashed my retinas, detached one, smashed my corneas, and caused internal energy in the vitreous humor of the eye. I was still standing. I wandered out the door, threading the side of the house to the backyard where I thought I remembered seeing my brother. He wasn't there. And it was out there that my aunt, who was visiting her mother next door, found me and took me on to the hospital where I stayed for the next month or so. Remember where I said my mother was?
She was
a bully. And my mother, strangely enough, this is where serendipity plays a part in all of this. My mother was bullied with her best friend and biggest competitor, Jim. And Jenny beat her 9 out of 10 games. And this wouldn't be a big deal, except that Jenny was totally blind. And my mother, while she appreciated that, and Jenny, by the way, told that three jokes in my experience, Jenny was teaching my mother about what blind people could do before she had to have a son who was suddenly blind. So when I woke up in the hospital, and I realized instantaneously that I couldn't see anyone. On the table next to my bed was a device called a talking watch. It was a record player that played at very slow RPM. And she had a stack of books there, checked out from the library, especially to distribute books, good old books. So I remember my first talking book was A New John, a great inspirational thing about living up to your potential. So I woke up. That was what life handed me. I went home 3 or 4 weeks later, remember getting out of the family car, wearing my first pair of sunglasses. At that time, it was because the doctor prescribed them, because light was very, very bright to me. Because people think that blindness somehow or other is total blackness. Most of those who are blind or visually impaired have vision. It's just not enough to be competitive without some assistance in that process. And competitive is not a nasty word for me. It's that ability to provide for myself and others for the reasonable amount of effort. So I had these dark glasses, and I remember stepping out of the car and having tears run down my face. Because in spite of all the love that I had been shown by my parents, by the family minister, by Jenny who came to visit me in the hospital every day, in spite of that, I was terribly afraid that my brothers and sisters would love me anymore. Because I was in a hospital wing for children, at least in those days, I don't know because I don't have any close kids. They wouldn't love kids to visit kids in the hospital, worried about, you know, measles. So I hadn't seen them for 3 long weeks, and I stepped out of that car. And you see, I still get choked up all right, thinking that they didn't love me, but I was anything but the case. But everyone in the family blamed themselves for my condition. My older brother says he was the one who taught me how to make the brew I was making that day. My sister had blown me off her plane that afternoon to go do something with her friend. And so she blamed herself for not being there. And the list went on and on, multi-generation. One of the things Jenny said to my mother, not just after I was blinded, but prior to that, was she was this kid who grew up as a totally blind kid and went to the local school for the blind and absolutely hated it. A very personal situation for her. She just absolutely loved it. So when my parents were asked, so are you going to have your son go to school for the blind or stay in public school? What was the answer? Public school. Jenny didn't realize that she was educating my mother to hate schools for the blind. But that was the result of all the things she had said about her parents. So nonetheless, I went to public school. I had an itinerant teacher who would come visit me for 3 to 5 hours a day for my first couple of years, 6th and 7th grade. Diminishing down to 1 hour a week by the time I graduated from high school. During that time, the only time I had interaction with other blind people was with Jenny. And during the summer months, when I attended a school for the blind summer event, kind of like Camp for the Blind, in Salem, Oregon, about 50, 60 miles south of where I grew up. So that's where you have to imagine me be. Second eldest, newly blinded, going to public school, lots of very active brothers and sisters, and medically experiencing a long road toward potential recovery. So, how does all of this apply to what I am now as an adult? Well, many things. One is, I don't think I'd be the same person if it weren't for the fact that I had Jenny in my life. Even before I was blind, my idea of what a blind person was, because I knew all of one, was they were really good bowlers. They told good jokes. And Jenny was a single mother of three. And she was a good cook. My mother's not here, so I can say she was a better cook than my mom. And she worked outside of home. So she was employed and doing all of these other things. So I had a pretty high estimation of what a blind person was going to be like. Now, most of those things are not true about your average blind person. But that was my one and only experience, and therefore it affected my idea of what I should do. It also affected the expectations of the people around me. My mother wanted me desperately to love the bowl. I hate bowling. But my mother wanted me to love bowling. She was the one responsible for getting me to and from innumerable doctor visits. So I became kind of I was not one of the regular kids. I spent much more of my time engaged in this thing called blindness, either from the medical model side of things or from the social side of things. my sister Brenda, who's my Irish twin. Is that a term people are familiar with? Mm-hmm. We're not a year apart, right? We're the same age for 9 days out of the year. She's redheaded and freckle-faced. And she was my first seen eye dog. She was the one who got me from school to home and back and forth to all those kinds of events. My brothers were a little more rough and tumble. The Christmas before I was blinded, the dad rolled out for each of us kids our own bicycles. So I had a red Stingray bicycle with the banana seat and the big monkey bar handlebars. And suddenly I couldn't ride a bicycle anymore. So my brothers snuck me out of the house and had my bicycle down at the neighbor's house. And we went bicycle riding. And they would ride their bicycles in front of me, well, maybe 10 feet forward there and 10 feet forward there, and I'd ride my bicycle behind them, and they would sing cigarette commercials. You can take Salem out of the country, but you can't take the country out of Salem. All of those jingles were my guys riding my bicycle. Can you imagine the looks on the neighbor's face with the blind kid going down the street and the brother singing cigarette commercials? That kind of, a little bit of devil in me made me do those kinds of things. My mother would say, if I came home and I was clean and tidy while the other brothers and sisters were not, I was to go back outside until I came in looking respectable. None of this taking the easy way to do things. Go out, be involved. My father, and this is one of the other benefits of my life, my father was a man who worked three jobs to put a house, roof over his family and feed them and clothe them. So he didn't see me as much as my mother did, of course. And he was very ashamed that his son was blinded while he was mowing the next door neighbor's lawn. I wasn't upset by that. He was doing what he taught me to do with his every act, which is to respect family, support family. So he's mowing my grandmother's lawn. But he wasn't there for me. So he wanted to take me into his arms and protect. My mother knew that if I didn't get some bumps and bruises, that I wasn't going to be ready for adulthood. I know that after you're done with me here, you're going to be going over and working with kids with disabilities, right?
Yes. Right.
Bumps and bruises are a good thing. A totally safe environment does not prepare you for everyday realities. So I was so lucky to have both parents, Dad, to hold me when I felt world was doing me dirt, and Mom to say, it's okay to experience that, son, but back on your feet now. Get it going. So, nonetheless, I went through regular high school, did all those kinds of things that you would expect a high school student to do. I was in wrestling, strictly junior varsity, but I do remember a victory one day. We moved from one school district to another, and I remember beating a kid who was in my class in the sixth grade when I was a freshman in high school. And when I pinned him, as I had him pinned to the mat, he said, do you remember me? Yeah. I whipped your ass, did you? Anyway, the long and the short of it is I grew up, graduated from high school like all my sighted peers. But I had very little connection with my blind peers. And I want you to be very cautious of using this word peer. You are my peers in that we are all here experiencing this experience of being in the United States. So on that level, you are my peer. Unlike if I were standing giving the same talk in the university in Uganda. Different experiences, not my peers at that level. And while there are age peers, I was for the most part denied access to my disability peers. Growing up, as a result of mainstream. We had to go out of our way for that not to happen. And with my mother's bias, as a result of Jenny's experience, it was something I had to reach out to accomplish. And I accomplished that by joining a group of blind and visually impaired college students in a group called the Oregon Alliance of Blind Students. And that's where I once again was introduced to a young woman that I knew when she was 12 and I was 13, attending one of these summer sessions. Her name's Kim. And she was the president. We were competition for one another throughout our childhoods. She was the ultimate in school for the blind kids. Valedictorian, cheerleader, all that kind of stuff. And I was the equivalent of that going to public school. I was my senior class president, for example. So I was very much socially engaged at that level. So anyway, she and I got to know one another again when we got, we're both college students. We had a little tiff over the cost of gas one time, so it broke up for a bit. But eventually, she attended Oregon College of Education. I attended Willamette University. They were about 50 miles apart. We were both majoring, surprise, surprise, in political science. And she got a job as an intern at the state legislature. And I was very interested in that. I chose my university because it was across the street from the state capitol, and I wanted to get there. So I went there and asked if she'd give me a tour. And that's when I discovered that my wife, to be, and I invested a lot of time and energy going back and forth from her university to mine. Eventually, she transferred to my university. We both graduated from there. We went out and bought a home. She got work. I didn't. And she went on to get a master's degree in library science while she was away from home for a year. If you, any of you are married, we think that's a problem. You can park that a lot. But she was gone for a year. While she was doing that, I was dodging bill collectors. I was unemployed. She was a college student. They had a lot more bills than they had income. I convinced the state agency for the blind, whose board I was appointed to by the then governor because of my political connections, to let me use their computer technology to teach myself. And in turn, I would turn around and teach them how to use it because they got this federal money to buy tech. The tech got bought, put in a closet, and nobody knew how to use it. So I convinced them that since I was on the board of directors and I had nothing better to do and wanted to stay away from the house, that they let me use their equipment. So I taught myself. Kim came home and almost immediately said, you know what? I've got a job offer in Massachusetts. This is coast-to-coast stuff. And I'd like to take it. And there's a passage in the Bible, I think, that says, where thou goest, I go. This is especially true if she's employed in your life. So we moved away from both of our families to Massachusetts. And she's now the director of the Perkins Braille and Talking Book Library, which serves 20,000 blind and visually impaired people as a lending library. And I was in Massachusetts at Watertown Square. Anybody driven to Watertown Square?
Yes.
Close your eyes and cross that intersection. I went from a state of 3 million, Boston area. It was a huge transition. The skills that I had developed in using the long white cane to get around my nice little grid neighborhood with low traffic in a city of 50,000 wasn't quite up to Watertown Square. But nonetheless, I survived it. I think I should get a t-shirt that has tire tracks on it saying, I survived Watertown Square. Well, it exposed me to some new tech. And now I'm going to launch into the whole tech side of things, if that's right. Before I move on to the text line, any questions about what I've covered so far? This is kind of the lives that your individual kids with disabilities are going to go through. It's not what you're doing with them today or this week. It's not how they're going to do in the short term. It's how they're going to do in the long term. That you are part of the team to accomplish, to get them that potential. My team was some professionals, my TVI, but the bigger part of my team with my family, and in those days, my regular public schoolmates and teachers, etc. Eventually, I graduated from college. I got married, and while I was in that process, I worked for the Oregon State Legislature as the Assistant Sergeant at our State Senate. That's the head gopher. The person who sent with documents for that important meeting down the hall. And by the way, while you're on the way there, pick me up a cup of coffee. You know, that kind of level of involvement. That's where I first started using technology. Because up to that point, technology for me was an electric typewriter. So I got my first computer-like device. It was called a Versa Braille 2B. And it was a cassette-based storage system that had an 18-character refreshable braille display. This is where electromechanical dots raise up and drop down to represent the braille, six dots in a braille cell. And this thing was capable of allowing me to write electronic notes, retrieve them, edit them, that kind of thing. And if I connected it up just the right way to a 300 baud acoustic coupler modem, I could kind of access some of the mainframe computer that was at the state legislature to know which committee was meeting in which room and was going to be reviewing which bill. The legislature wasn't set up for somebody who works on the Senate floor to do that, so I literally had to balance this thing in my lap in a phone booth, connected up through that phone system into the internet. It was my first experience with that. Only reason I could have that device is the state's agency, the one whose board I'm on, provided it to me on loan, because this was back in 77, 78 in that time frame, and that device cost $5,000 then. I don't want to think that inflation would cost it to cost now relative to income. But I got to use that. When I lost my job there, because this Oregon legislature, unlike here, only is in session every other year, I scrambled for other jobs, so I ran a restaurant, 52-seat cafeteria-type restaurant. I worked for the city of Salem as a human rights specialist. I had regained a little bit of vision due to a couple of surgeries that allowed me to see letters if they were that tall. Not a great way to read books. But it allowed me to sort the mail, which was part of my job. Eventually, however, like I said, I got in contact with the commission. I found out that they had these computers they were bellyaching about as an example of federal money gone bad, and taught myself to use an Apple II Plus computer. Then we had speech access to it because we put a card inside of the computer, an electronic card in the computer that was used for other people to play games. So we'd do things like and things like that. Well, the programmers were very clever and taught it to say things like, hello. And I had to learn that that was the word hello. So I taught myself how to use that computer. I had a special software, a talking word processor, a talking spreadsheet, a talking, well, this was before the days of the internet. So, you know, those little tiny talking utilities to do this. And my wife came home and said, we're moving. I said, fine, we're moving. And then moved to Massachusetts, where I applied at this place called the Carroll Center for the Blind for a part-time temporary substitute teacher job. That's when everybody's leaving because they're in the third year of a three-year federal grant. What happens in office? Everybody's worried the grant money's gonna dry up, they're gonna be unemployed, so they start looking for work elsewhere. So I became the lead instructor at the Carroll Center in technology in 3 weeks. And been there now for 25 years. Technology is part of my everyday life. And I'm going to talk to you a bit about that to conclude things. How am I doing your life?
About a half hour.
Good. I didn't do too bad, first of all. All right, so a day in the life of a blind tech user. When I get up in the morning, I get woke up by an alarm clock, probably not too dissimilar to what your experience is. Only my alarm clocks have taken different shapes over the years. My first alarm clock was a little West Bend wind-up that my mother pried the plastic face off of so I could touch the hands on the clock, the analog clock. And I was very proud of that. I had to earn that by folding many, many, many loads of laundry. That was one of those things that my mother taught me, was that just because I was blind didn't mean that I didn't have family responsibilities like everybody else. Maybe I wasn't going to be out mowing the lawn, but I was going to become the best laundress this world had ever seen. And I still fold towels just so. I drive my wife totally nuts. When she does the laundry, which is not that often, I hate to sneak it out in the middle of the night before. Anyway, so, but my talking clock changed when suddenly, if you'll pardon the expression, nearsighted people saw speech as kind of a fun gizmo. So my next clock came from Radio Shack. It's wonderful. I've got a talking clock now that I don't have to go damage somebody else. I don't have to go buy something that's for the blind. I just buy a novelty item and hope that it continues to be amusing to sighted people so that they continue to be available. In fact, the first talking clock I had went out of manufacture before this one went in. And I literally went out and bought three of the old ones before they went out of manufacture and worried that they'd never come back again. My latest talking clock. Let's see if shit don't work. Ah! This one was talking to us the entire time we were coming down here in the car. It's touch sensitive. You can just touch it. It tells you, it says, hello, this is motion. How may I help you? And I can say time, because it has speech recognition, and will tell me the time. Sometimes it doesn't understand me properly, and it tells me the temperature, and I have to deal with it. That's kind of cool. I've got the bigger one in my living room, and I don't have to touch to get its attention. I just have to say, hello, motion. Unfortunately, it sees certain top 10 tunes as saying hello, motion. So if I'm playing music in the living room, I oftentimes have to go over and tell motion. I don't need to know the time. Timepieces, a lot of what is adaptive technology short of that computer over there is measuring devices. Measuring time would be one example. Talking clocks are in households. Almost all the blind people that I know. Sometimes they're a feature in a device, but they're there. And they're important to us, maybe even a little more important than they are to you, because you can glance out the window and know whether it's AM or PM, for the most part. Me, I need to have something that I can ask that question. I also use the Braille watch to keep track of time, because nobody appreciates being woken up in the middle of the night screaming at my wife by me touching the talking clock. So I wear a watch today, so I don't wake up my wife wondering whether I woke up too late or too early to go. Clocks. So I woke up this morning to a clock. Got up, my family speaks for an extra 30 minutes, so I get used to the restroom, so it's off to the restroom I go. And in spite of what you see before you, I am working on my weight. So, but unlike you, when I go in, I can just quietly step on the scale, because it's a talking scale. So what I do is I turn on the sink, flush the toilet, turn on the shower, so there's all that water, and then I step on. So the whole family doesn't get to hear how much I weigh this morning. I don't want them to talk around. Okay? It's a talking scale. It's a for-the-blind product. So take what you pay for a scale of similar capability and triple the price. That's what it costs me to do that. So I also noticed, maybe out of the shower, that my wife has been once again playing with the thermostat, and it's cold in the house. So I walk down the hall, and I deal with my thermostat. Now, my previous thermostat was one of those Honeywell dial ones. And all I did to adapt it was to take some peel-and-stick dots that you use to keep your cupboard doors from sliding shut and put them in strategic places around the dial. That turned these two to match up, and that's the nighttime temperature, and it needs to line up, and it's the daytime temperature. Well, nowadays, nobody has thermostats like that. Who's paying for the bill? We get the fancier ones where we can program it to go down if we forget to turn it down, those kind of things. So I have one. It's a talking thermostat. Controls the heating and cooling in my home, AM, PM, weekday, weekends, all that kind of fun stuff, and I can use the keys on it in order to control all of that stuff. It's a great little talking thermostat. It comes from a great company who has, in talking on the way here this morning, we were talking about brand names. What would you call a company that sells, manufactures and sells talking thermostats? Talking thermostats. That's what they call it. Talking thermostats. So I deal with the thermostat. I go into the kitchen. I go over to the microwave because there's inevitably something left over that needs heating up in the morning for breakfast. And I turn to my Hamilton Beach microwave. My guess is if you have a microwave, you don't remember what the brand name is. I remember because Hamilton Beach, about 3 years ago, came out with a talking microwave oven. For the general public, because apparently sighted people don't see the microwave very well first thing in the morning. They want to warm up something, so they have it talking. And that's great, because this thing only costs me $99. The last talking microwave I got was for the mind, and it cost me $600 for the same features. It's manufactured specially for the blind. I used to say add a zero. Now it's only about $300. So that gets warmed up. Guide dogs go out. The guide dogs come in. I said, guide dog, yes, I am typically a guide dog user. I'm a cane user right now because I'm between dog number 4 and 5. I've decided to give my heart a rest from the loss of dogs. When they talk about all the hassles of being a guide dog user, you think about taking the dog out in the middle of the storm to relieve it. But my life, the hard part about being a heavy drug user is the emotional loss when you lose them. Because you spend more time with that animal than you do anything else. You do work, you take them home, you take them on the road, they're with you all the time. And I can't take another loss soon after that. So I'm between dogs, but my wife is blind, she has a guide dog, and she has a 14-year-old retired guide dog, and I'm her primary caregiver, so out she goes. So not all of my technology has on-off switches. Some of them, you need a Cooper Scooper to deal. Come back into the house. Now, if I'm smart, I've arranged my so that I do a little bit of prep for dinner in the morning, but I can go through making dinner quicker in the evening. So, and I'm not going to tell you, oh, it's not too hard to improve, that if I could do something else than work with access technology, I would be a chef. But yay, food TV chef. They live a lifestyle I love to live. Food TV at all, I get you my guess. So this is my talking kitchen scale. And again, I don't mind if it tells the family how much I've got in the bowl. That's perfectly okay. So I have a whole series of kitchen gizmos that help me do things. This one, I found out that the battery died. I haven't used it in a week, so I've got to get new batteries in that. So that's to measure quantities of things, more measurement. This is a talking thermometer. I didn't get this for what you would imagine that is cooking in the house. I got this because I have a smoker. So I use smoked ribs and pulled pork and all that kind of stuff during the summer. And I need to know the temperature of the pork because it's very slow. So this is a talking thermometer. So it can tell me the temperature. It's an instant read talking thermometer that I can use to pull out the, you know, the rack, the book from the oven and poke it in, push the button, and wait for a moment for the temperature to be. Price tag on that, if you were to go and buy an instant thermometer, times three. This one's about $75. It's not cheap being the wine person. If I haven't impressed you with anything else with my discussions tonight, this ain't a cheap thing to be. To be a person with a disability has extra cost. And it has to be part of your life to keep that into consideration. When I am done getting myself ready in terms of kitchen things, I think that covers the kitchen things, I have to go get myself dressed to go to work anymore. This is not an easy thing to do. Because when you went in and Larry and I looked at what you were wearing today, you knew what went together because you could see colors. But I bought a gizmo. Talking color identifier. Let's see how accurate it's going to be this morning.
Deep charcoal gray.
Deep charcoal gray. How do you do? Not too bad.
Murky indigo.
It's a positive thing. But indigo is a shade of blue, is it?
Yeah.
Not too bad. Have some striped shoes. That would be different because it depends on where I touch it. So frequently I'll have to towards replace it and see if it doesn't match. Well, I'm still in that whole blue thing. Now comes enough to drive even the identifier back. How'd that say it goes with the pants?
Mid-gray.
Mid-gray, shade gray.
Mid-gray. Doctor machine.
Now. Does anybody know the shade of aubergine? This was originally created in Austria. So aubergine must be some color with the Austrian. Deep chocolate. So what color am I now? Lots of colors, right? So this color identifier thing works really well. So you'll find that most of my clothes our solid color shirts, solid color pants, and I own 180 ties. I know that because that's what my tie rack holds. And whenever somebody gives me a new tie, one has to go. I'm done. So I'm very careful at how I put those in the closet. Though there are other ways to mark your clothes. You can braille on some diamonds. into the tie and have a little number and a chart on the back of the door that tells you this tie looks like a Salvador Dali painting, the chest pieces that are up, you have that tie. Color identifier, kind of a useful thing, $150. And not 100% successful, and there are colors it doesn't get. So, color identifier. Part of my life is also medical. Just because I'm an adult now and taking care of my vision is not my big thing anymore, doesn't mean I don't have medical issues I have to deal with. And they all have some technical components. Thermometer. This time, not intended to stick into a big frost. And is it on? Come on. That's the other. Color identifier. Shut this up off. Start my day with bills. And the box comes from the pharmacy, wonderfully labeled it in print and not in any other identifiable way. Now, I happen to be lucky enough that I was a doctor, so I have a Braille label attached to that. But the next time I fill this, I get a new bottle. And I'm lazy like everybody else, and they all don't get labeled right. So I got this new gizmo, and it is a device. Unfortunately, my wife went and borrowed the bottle that goes with it, and then he can't the pills from the bottle that came in, putting it aside for the re-upping whenever I'm into this alternative bottle, put it in here, and I can make it so that each bottle that sits in this little base, if I push the button below it. Horrible sound in the recording. But it's enough here. This is why I take two twice a day. So by the time I get that bottle, I give it a magnetic label on the bottom of it, and it matches with this base. Put it in, push the button, it will tell me what it is. And it can have a lot more information on it than this Braille label can. It can have what the drug is, what the dosage is, what kind of things I should be careful. All of those things should be on this thing. Again, $150. Not currently covered by medical insurance. I am a type 2 diabetic. Bigger part of the society is like me, I'm afraid. So, I remember the day that I was in the doctor's office and they decided, Brian, you're type 2 diabetic. I think this was the time when they moved the goalposts. I had the same blood sugar as the time before, but they changed the definition of diabetic and brought the number closer to me, so I stepped over line by line, stepping over me. Anyway, long and short of the dog is, they said, and we'll need you to take your blood sugar twice a day. Normally, we give somebody a glucose monitor to do this. We have them here in the drawer. But they don't talk. So what we'll want you to do is to stop by the doctor's office each morning and each evening. And we'll take it. And I said, stop. Think about that for me. Are you insane? This must be the same mentality that caused a flight attendant the other day to tell me, in case of emergency, just remain seated until everybody else gets off and I'll come back for you. So I said, no, in fact, I know there are talking glucose monitors. I'll need you to get one more. And they said, you work for a finance agency, don't you? I said, yeah. Couldn't you get one? I said, yeah, but you know what? Last time I paid my insurance premium, I'm paying you for that expertise. So call me when I'm at work and I'll give you some advice on where you can go get one. So eventually, they went and got me one. And the original one was the size of a shoebox. And you would simply take an existing glucose monitor and connect it up to the shoebox device that would convert everything to a code in speech. Kind of expensive and very, very awkward to use. My latest one is this one. Much smaller. And although I'm not going to do my blood sugar for you right now, the fact of the matter is that it will cause it to talk about the scripting. I really think that's what made me feel better about sticking myself at the phone. I don't know what it really does. I haven't looked at this at an auction, fundraising auction. for a blinded agency and company that came up with this idea, decided to go out and promote it. The fact of the matter is, though, there was a time when the last manufacturer of talking glucose machines was going out of business and there was nobody stepping up. We had a 3-year period where pharmacies were not yet that medical device. And one of the major causes of the blindness is?
Diabetes.
How insane is this? But nonetheless, that's some of the medical things that are part of my day job. There's a lot of crazy things in this universe that have to do with things people think are obvious, but are not. One of them is, what is it? Or is it the 20? Of all of the industrialized nations in this world, the United States is the only one that doesn't have a need for letters to tell the difference in denomination of paper currency. We have to sue the government because the Department of the Treasury said it would be too expensive to do that. Too expensive for the United States to do it. And it wasn't too expensive for Uganda to do it. Don't believe the government. So we advocated and advocated and advocated, and finally we sued them, and they appealed the suit, and we took it all the way to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court said, are you out of your mind? Of course it's our responsibility to do that. Not just a matter of how. So we appealed the government, and they said, yes, you're right, we ought to do it. Let's commission a study. And then another study. And then another study. So we finally got them in the process of doing this. They've been dragging their feet, hoping that, you know, the client answer to their problem. But it is not the same kind of situation. This required batteries. This does not. This requires that I go out and buy something and keep it in good repair. This does not. So, this money, if I take this bill and slide it into the edge of this money identifier, that costs me $120 and push this button, it's a error. At least it didn't tell me what the value of the bill. Now it is trying to feed paper money into a coin-op machine. And I said, what? So I can now identify my money. So I have no excuse for what happened to me back when I first took a trip and accidentally tipped the quarter of 20 and tried to get that with a wallet. Doesn't work. So it's mostly a part in my life, and I haven't even gotten to work yet. And work is not something that starts and stops in a 9-to-5 kind of situation for me any more than it probably does for you. So some of the tech that I use at home, I also use at work. Some of the tech that I work, I also use at home. And I have in front of me now my laptop computer. And this is my computer for the line. It's just a computer. I thought this had a desktop thing.
Type this from the Internet Explorer.
Synthetic speech.
Desktop or built into Internet Explorer 15.6. Slower.
I'll take pity on you, and if you don't listen to synthetic speech, and slow it down.
Title is desktop.
Title is desktop. Now, my first talking computer, oh, this one's not a pretty good one, isn't it? The next generation, which I'm already working with, you would be hard pressed to tell the difference between it and a human being, unless you can listen to their experience. They even laugh, chuckle, a little too avatarish for me. Nonetheless, all the things that you think of when you do a computer.
W Winum. W Winmat. W Wordlist. W Word 2010.
What version of Word are you using? I've got the latest and greatest. This is all called adaptive technology because we're adapting to a universe that didn't have speech or braille or large print in mind. And so the thing has to come out. But that window between when something comes out and when something becomes accessible has been shrinking dramatically during the 25 years that I've been with computers. I'm going to choose
W4 2007.
Because I'm still in transition.
Enter. I've been wanting my software pretty bad.
By the way, each time it's new in the application, it goes back to my default speed and things. I'm going to slow that down.
Slower.
I've been asked to read the title bar.
This document was at Microsoft Word, pretty new.
And I've been asked to read the status bar.
Title is document one.
I'm going to type something.
N-O-double-space-I-S-space-C-A-E-space-E-I-E-space-O-R-space.
So I can hear letter by letter and typing, and if you notice.
Oh, N, O.
And it's.
N.
Different sounding than.
O.
O. Higher pitch means our case.
It is the time.
I can.
Four, land. Space, land.
Now, I'm moving this to your current individual character. I can set this up so that it's quiet while I'm typing, but I'll speak as I move my cursor across the
air. Space, period, Y-R-T-N.
And I will word by word.
Up there, up there.
Now, that's great.
To, come to, men, to.
I'm moving the word to. I know I'm on the first letter of the word to. This is all the first letter we move. On Mac, you can Mac users, the world wants to be. Where's the cursor when you're moving back and forth? Going forward, it's just past what you and you move back, it's just before what you so it's slightly different than what we're in. So when I switch back and forth in Mac and Windows-based system, it can be a little bit donkey for you. All right, nonetheless, I can now. So I had it. Why did I want to show you that at all of them is because as that blind college student, for me to create the paper that I had to turn in, I went to the library with a sighted work study student. I had to learn to manage people very early in life, that person with a disability, and have them help me create the research. I had to know what I was doing. They were something they pulled out of the book. Individual confidence, go to this chapter, read that to me, and I have my Perkins Braille writer with me, weighed 15 pounds. I mean, it's a mechanical device, embossed Braille on individual pieces of paper. Write up my notes, go back to my room, compose on that Braille writer my paper, then read that paper and type it again into my typewriter without the ability to make corrections unless I copy error the moment I made. So I read a line of Braille. So what am I going to listen to what I'm doing and type this in a long time? And if I hit that one, backspace, then I'm going to go to the page, I pull out the ink cartridge, put in the correct cartridge, type that letter, pull out the correct cartridge, put in the ink cartridge, backspace again, type the right one. Now, I did that one. Are all things, tools that help me be a more successful blind person in all aspects of my life. More successful as a person who lives independently, as a person who consumes goods and services independently, by medical service. Also making me successful at employment. And let me tell you, all of the things that I thank each one of my parents for. My mother for a forget attitude, a fear of failure, no reason not to try. And my father for work ethic, that there's value in work, and there's equal value to the guy who grows your vegetables as the guy who teaches your children. They both perform an important value in their So I'm very lucky because I am not a typical blind person. A typical blind person is over 65 years old. A typical blind person is blind not all their life, but as a matter of aging. A typical blind person has a 70% chance of being unemployed, even if they are otherwise qualified to work. A typical blind person does not have sufficient funds to buy these devices in the way that I've been unemployed, otherwise employed. We are both in middle management type positions, so we make sufficient funds. And if we see something that can make our life better, we should get it. Today, my wife went online and bought a $1,200 new bus. She was just diagnosed with celiac disease. You ready for the celiac? So, suddenly, gluten is for mold. Right? So, how do you know whether a package? Whether
whether a package be complete or not, as a grocery shop. You read the label. Aaron, you don't read a label like that. So we got your box that is a barcode for you that talks. So we will take a snapshot of that. Usually you'll find a barcode large. So we'll take a snapshot of that. It has a catalog in it of several million items. And it will go to that catalog in Europe and tell us that this is what you need to bring over there. Curry rice. We'll cook the curry rice and read us all the product information. Not what you need on the box, but comparing the account. $1,200 to do that. And if I can deduct it from my taxes, because I've been enough on medical things in the year that that's an option for me, then I'll get some value back on that, right? I'm not the member of a tax bracket, I mean, but I don't think it'll wonderful experience for that. And if I was on a fixed income, which most of you are, I'm going to be in a situation where I'm going to have to do without that. Instead, either take my chances or rely on friend assistance. So, technology is partly a good thing if you do all these things well. But part of that technology gain is, I have one know that it exists. I had an 83-year-old lady come into my office the other day. There's a sense that he buy her a talking computer if she went and got screened and how to use it. And that was the smartest thing his son could ever say. Not to just go and buy that talking computer and say, Mom, here is the bone of rust. It is a matter of not only knowing what's out there, she can ask me those questions, being able to afford to buy it, and lastly, learning how to use it. I run an office program at Carroll Town, where we teach 250 face-to-face, 250 blind people a year how to use adaptive technology for some purpose they want to use it for. In this case, I'm not primarily nurse for education and employment. However, if I have 250 this year, 250 next year, 250 next year, 250 next year, knowing that there are 40,000 blind and visually impaired people in the state of Massachusetts, of which probably 10,000 could readily use my service and benefit from it. I'm going to go to school. There is demand. There is supply. There is need to finance them to get. State agency for the blind primarily does that training has been level funded in that area for 9 years. And we actually did the bill to state less per hour this year than we did 10 years ago. I mean, the cost of labor went down, the cost of any of this stuff went down. It just simply isn't fixed. So I want to assure you that I'm a believer in technology. I'm also a person who knows that it takes knowing where it's available, being able to acquire it in some fashion, and learning to use it effectively. So, we have very little time left.
We have about 3 or 4 minutes, but I'm just wondering if you
still have a question.
In terms of presenting your questions, just present it verbally.
Unless you got bells on your wrist today.
I try. This is a technology made much where when you dream, you see images and sounds. So,
one of the things that happen when you're alive is they have not. I feel it's an obligation to benefit blind people. When you heard my introduction, when you heard about talking hands, I was involved in giving those stuff. The temple warnings, the brief complicated subway platforms. I had a friend die off of one of the platforms at the third rail a couple of decades ago. And we forced the government to pay those standard procedures so blind people didn't off of the deaths. And I participate in research studies as a community. And so I've been involved in a number of them. One of which I wanted to bring. Because I was blinded at 11, when I was first blinded, all my life experiences were. And then as more and more of my life experiences were non-visual, I began to be less and less visual in nature. I went to what I call the orphan anti-stage, where I didn't have enough visual memory of how people look, so the faces became mostly a full face in my mind's eye. And eventually they became distinct, less definition as or where you are, to what meant by one person or another visual. And now, all my breathing is experiential, that is, the sense of motion, sound. I had a discussion with a bunch of people the other day. Many of you will see is 50% responsible for meals. And she's responsible for being the primary shopper for groceries. I do the laundry, I do the housing, I do the cleaning, all the yard maintenance. My wife does the thinking part, the paperwork, and communication. So we have this interdependent being who not have a car if I didn't own it. Because she doesn't make enough money, she's a career supervisor, life career for long. She doesn't make enough money to do that. To really maintain a car or a lifestyle the way that we have it. So it's kind of in the pay in that scenario. She would readily admit everything I just said and smile at us and enjoy eating well. Well, thank you all for being here. I hope that was some